Hello to the viewers. Thank you all for joining us today. My name is Sushmita and I'll be your moderator for the evening. I know you're all just settling in and trickling in as we start our season finale, our 10th live series of the lecture series. And MindSperm has been doing these virtual lecture series to kind of connect field experts and professors and help them contextualize this pandemic and their subject. So right from the beginning, we've got from topics like desire to ecosophy, the changes in demographics, women and vulnerable groups. And today it brings me a lot of pride to be concluding this season's finale with a very special speaker. And around areas of Delhi to the downtrodden and those who've been affected the most. You will find their links to donate and to also reach out to them on our social media links on Instagram and Facebook, and also on this YouTube link later. So please do go ahead, give them a look and do as much as you can. So without much further ado, we have Ms. Panu Bedi. She's an advocate in the High Court of Punjab and Haryana. It's been wonderful knowing her. It's almost a very funny story as to how we met, but child was being decided by the court to be aborted, and these proceedings and these cases have led to a lot of changes in society. And after winning them,
hello, good evening everyone. I hope I am audible. Sushmita, your voice was cracking in between, maybe because of some problem with the internet connection, so I really could not understand exactly what did you say for me, but as I understand what I'm supposed to do as my duty on this talk, so I start straight away. And I'm very hopeful that my voice is audible and clear to all the audience who have taken out their time and is a part of this effort of MindSperm to educate people, to fertilize their minds with the thoughts about which they have never thought before. So my heartiest congratulations, first of all, to the entire team of MindSperm, and especially to you, Sushmita, for coming out with a very nice and creative word, adcovating, in the times of COVID-19, which in fact, when I shared with some of my known people to join for this talk. They said it is a typographical error and how could you could not point it out to the organizers. I was like, this is done by the students who are very creative and they think out of the box. And I was so happy to read that comment that finally, where the youngsters are thinking out of the box, coming up with the new ideas, the old generation is still stuck on the typographical mistakes, the correct spelling and how things have to be done. So I'm very happy that you have chosen this talk as edcovating, which on a lighter side made me think that just by replacing two words in advocate, we and C, we could show that there is a COVID virus always in the advocates. I'm so sorry to my colleagues for this, maybe not a very good sense of humor, but on a serious side, I also think that edcovating as an advocate would definitely mean that the vocal cords which are given to advocates to fight for and present their case in the court, one side, is very much relevant in the present times of this pandemic, where the situation of COVID has created so much of fear, so much of paranoia, so much of information, misinformation, that everybody is just listening without asking the questions. So my effort in this talk, which I would want to clarify, I have written few things and I'll be reading to do complete justice to everyone who has come here so that I don't digress and keep dwelling on one topic more than it is needed. I want to clarify first to everyone that I am not here to give any lecture. Whatever I am sharing with you is not about right or wrong. It's not about that one should believe in how I believe. My only effort is to share some information, some provisions of law, how I understood them, and then to instill in all of you the curiosity to look for more for what I had shared. So that after listening to the talk which we are discussing today, you are forced to cross-check every information which I give to you on this platform. Because as I see it, this pandemic is not about coronavirus-induced COVID-19. The real disease which had marred all of us for a very long time and has taken the proportion of pandemic now is our gullibility to believe everything shown by media or any other platform and get virus fear, which is more dangerous than coronavirus. So my request to you today, all the listeners, is that whatever I speak today, please don't jump on it as a gospel truth. I have my conditioning, so I think, see things in a certain way. I request all of you to do your independent research, to know more or maybe the different side of what I am going to share, which is my perspective, and which I know that it is not the only and the perfect perspective on the issues which we are facing right now. So my request is, as we dwell deep into legal side of pandemic COVID-19, I request all of you to please simultaneously release yourself from the disease of gullibility, eat vitamin curiosity in high dosages every day, take a deep breath right now and swallow a big pill of this vitamin. This, I'm sure, will definitely help all of us to bring a question mark to everything we listen to, everything we read, and finally get our answers as we need in the present times, not as media is telling us to believe. Metaphorically, we are in our universe. We have, I always see Ursa Major in his question mark shape as telling us that please question mark everything. So I request you, first of all, before I begin my discussions today, be curious, ask questions, find answers, and never settle for any one particular version of things. There are sides, many sides, not just two sides of a coin. We are not dealing with currency all the time. There are many sides, and try to explore every side and take my discussion today also with a pinch of salt. So with this introductory things which I wanted to share with everyone, how you should take my lecture or also any other lecture, I start with my discussion on the legal side of pandemic. This word pandemic is taken a big toll on our life. Not only it has causing us stress, but every day we are using it in our conversation. It is a part of our daily life. Every hour some discussion comes around this. But have we ever bothered to know the meaning of pandemic and how it is different from epidemic? The little search which I could do told me that this difference between epidemic and pandemic is only the word P, which means passport. So when a disease has gone beyond the geographical barriers and has reached different parts of the world, it becomes pandemic. So that is how COVID-19 situation right now, as the World Health Organization has labeled it, is a pandemic. But the word pandemic does not exist in any of the legal provisions of India. So if we see how, under what provisions of law, the court is passing different orders trying to handle or manage the COVID-19 situation, the pandemic word itself is not defined anywhere, not even mentioned. The word epidemic is mentioned in an old act, which we'll be referring to in a moment. But most of the orders which central government is passing is under the National Disaster Management Act 2005. And they have brought the situation of COVID-19 under the word disaster in the definition of the act. It is a different question, which is a matter of legal interpretation, whether word disaster can cover the COVID-19 situation or not. But as on today, the government has passed all of its orders, direction, guidelines under National Disaster Management Act of 2005. But the state government, which is at the helm of affairs and is managing many things and coming up with different orders and controlling our lives, is using the other act, which is called Epidemic Disease Act, 1897. So as the year suggests, this was the time when we were under the colonial governance of British rule. We didn't have our freedom. We didn't have our constitution. There was nothing called fundamental rights. And this act was passed, which has given basically all powers to the state government to control, to pass any orders, to do whatever they want to control the situation, which has arisen because of threat or the actual existence of any epidemic disease, which is called a dangerous epidemic disease. I request all of you, it is a 2-page act, which having 4.5 sections, two-way was introduced later to give some more power to the central government. Central government has no role under this act. Just read it. It's a 4.5 pages act. I strongly recommend, suggest everyone to please read this act and then try to see whatever is happening to us and the orders which are given by the authorities under this act. Does it actually meet with the requirement and spirit of the act as it exists in the statute? So the act uses, which is just 4 sections act, uses the word dangerous epidemic diseases. It doesn't tell us what is dangerous and what will amount to an epidemic, but it does just uses the word dangerous epidemic. State has a responsibility to see if there is any threat of such a disease. And if there is a big if, they also come to a satisfaction that whatever ordinary provisions of law, they are not sufficient to deal with the situation. Then they can invoke the provision of this act and they can make temporary regulation, which could include inspection in railways, segregations, temporary accommodation. But there was nothing stipulated under the act as like lockdown, curfew-like situation, that there will not be any railways at all, buses at all. This is not the in the illustrations given in the act mentioned, but yes, government has been given very wide powers to do anything, whatever they wanted, to control the spread of any epidemic. And this also mentions simultaneously, this very act, that while the authorities are laying down the guidelines, the restrictions, they will also simultaneously make arrangement for fixing the responsibility to defray the expenses or compensation. So meaning thereby, that time also, the government, which was a colonial government, was aware that the restrictions would bring certain hardships, will affect the people's life, which had to be compensated for. And there will be arrangement simultaneously that, yes, these are the guidelines and these guidelines are going to be implemented in this way. This will result in these hardships and there will be this kind of compensation. So this was what the scheme of the act, when we didn't have any fundamental rights, we have nothing at that time. It was 1897 Colonial Act. Still, there was special care taken for giving of the compensation. But as on today, as I see the present situation, where state after state has come with the different orders under this act. Every state has their own orders. Anyone has talked about any compensation and the method of its differing. So everybody has used the first part of the act. The second part of the act, which talks about the compensation, I don't see any effort on the ground by the authorities concerned. So this is one act which is used, which was before the constitution and before we got our fundamental rights. The situation changes in a very big way when we get our constitution in 1950. We all know that we adopted our constitution on 26 November 1949 and we became completely a republic by notifying this constitution on 26 January 1950, 26 January our Republic Day. I know as a lawyer, we start our study with a constitution, but I think as a citizen of our country, when your everything is governed by the constitution, I strongly urge everybody who have not read constitution so far, so please start reading it. We really, really need to know our constitution to assert our rights, especially in the present times when there is a blur of what is public interest, what has to be done by the government, and how under the guise of public interest, the very public interest of the public is being compromised. And we can understand this distinction only when we are aware of our rights. So one article 13 of the constitution says, and we all know that our constitution starts with the preamble where we have stated, we the people of India have given ourselves to this constitution. So article 13 says that there cannot be any law which is inconsistent with the fundamental rights. Meaning thereby, if there is a law which infringes a fundamental right or which takes away any fundamental right, that law will cease to be a law. Article 13 talks about two things. The law which had already come into picture because of the laws passed by the British government or maybe from 47 to 50, when Indian government has taken over, all those laws have to pass the test of constitutionality. And constitutionality means they should not infringe any fundamental right. And Article 13 also says further, in future also, state cannot come with any law which will violate your fundamental right. Not only law, if you read that article, whenever you go back, you will see the article has very clearly mentioned even bylaws, rules, regulation. So the constitution has given very important place to your fundamental rights. What are those fundamental rights? Will be coming. Some of you might be knowing it. We'll discuss one by one, which were our fundamental rights, what happened to them during this COVID situation. So this is very clear that our constitution has given a lot of importance to fundamental right, and no law in past or in future can be passed which can violate our fundamental rights. So we have to be very, very clear in our mind that our fundamental rights are non-negotiable. Even the laws cannot be made to dilute them or undermine them. You might be surprised that why I'm referring to read the constitution again and again. So there is something which I've always believed in, I'm sharing with all of you, that as Indian citizens, what we should believe in, that na Gita, na Granth, na Bible, na Quran. Hamara asli dharam, hamara margdarshak hai hamara samvidhan, our constitution. So if we understand what is this holy book called constitution, mean for India and Indian citizen, is this that the government which is ruling us, which is passing the order, whom we elect, the entire procedure, the entire authority, the legitimacy drive is coming from the constitution. We have the constitution, that is why the government comes into picture. The law that government makes is all authorized to be passed by the constitution. And this very constitution, which we the people of India gave to us for justice, liberty, equality, fraternity, as mentioned in preamble, it not only just gives us our fundamental rights, something new, we were not getting something out of somewhere that yes, for the first time in 1950, Indians would get this, which was not available to them before and which could not be available. No, the constitution only reinforces in those fundamental rights that as a human being, there is certain things which are non-negotiable, which have to be there with everyone. And when there is a democratically elected government, utmost duty is to protect and preserve those fundamental rights at every cost. So fundamental rights, we have to be very clear, are not negotiable. Constitution has given them very, 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 very important place in the entire arrangement of provisions of Constitution. If I go on the importance of fundamental rights, as our Supreme Court has said in many judgments, we can have discussions on weeks. So I leave that task for you. Go do some research. How important are fundamental rights to the Constitution and to our living? Before I come to that, what happens to those fundamental rights in the present time, I want to discuss one very peculiar situation which happened in our past, which many of you would be aware of, was the 1975 emergency. It was a June 1975. The emergency was proclaimed under Article 352. So I request all of you to read that also whenever you get time. That time, Article 352 has three provisions. One was that government can come with the emergency on external aggression, war, and internal disturbance. So the clause of internal disturbance was used by the government to put emergency and also come with a certain other acts which they thought will not be judicially scrutinized because of other provisions in the Constitution itself. Article 358 specifically says that when there is an emergency, Article 19, which is right to freedom of speech, moving, trade, assembly, would be suspended. And interestingly, in 1975, Article 359 says that during emergency, we can't even move to court for the enforcement of fundamental right. Government had passed a law, MISA, Maintenance of Internal Security Act. Some of you might be aware of which led to Lalu Prasad Yadav's daughter's name because he was imprisoned under this act when she was born. I understand it's getting too technical for many of you, but it is very important for us to understand this phase of our constitution, legal history, judicial appreciation to see what is very important today and how we have to take a stand for the protection of our fundamental rights. So that time what happened was many people were arrested, and as Article 359 has completely suspended the right to move to the court for enforcement of fundamental rights, people were not able to seek the legal remedies. Despite that, high courts have started protecting the liberty of fundamental rights, especially Article 21. The matter reached the Supreme Court. And Supreme Court, in the case of ADM Jabalpur versus Shivkant Shukla, which is also known as the darkest time of the Indian judiciary, five judges bench, out of that, four judges held that, yes, during emergency, fundamental rights cease to exist. They go away when the emergency comes. In the only dissent was of Justice Khanna, who says, no, the fundamental rights cannot go like that on the proclamation of emergency by the government. But anyhow, the majority judgment was that fundamental rights were not given its importance as it is mentioned in the Constitution by the Supreme Court. That led to further, when Indira Gandhi government was not elected, the Janata Party government came to power in 77, 78 came amendment in Constitution, which is the reason that today the government is not able to invoke the emergency provisions despite COVID-19 situation. In 1978, in 44th amendment, the government did two things. They removed the word internal disturbance. So now the word was substituted by armed rebellion. Other two things were war and external aggression. So internal disturbance was not anymore available to proclaim emergency. And most importantly, in Article 359, which earlier prohibited going to court for the enforcement of fundamental rights, they made a proviso that for Article 21, which is right to life, and now we will see how this right is the soul of the all fundamental rights and includes everything in it, that cannot be suspended even during emergency. So the reason for me to discuss this aspect with you was that in emergency, fundamental rights were compromised in one instance of our history. Later on, the damage was undone, provisions were changed, and it was ensured that in future, no situation arises in which fundamental rights can be compromised. So even if today emergency is declared, fundamental rights under Article 21 and 20 cannot be taken away. And I just want to remind all of you that we don't have any emergency. All the orders of law, which is controlling us, putting us under lockdown and other things which have happened, are passed under either Epidemic Disease Act of 1897 or National Disaster Management Act of 2005. So the first lockdown order of the government, which was the guidelines of ministry under NDMA of 2005 on 24th March, was under provisions of National Disaster Management Act, which some people say resulted in virtual imprisonment to us. And if you read the entire statute, you will see that it is debatable whether the situation of COVID-19 pandemic or epidemic can be under the word disaster. And even if it does come under it, because that talks about substantial loss of lives having already occurred. But we leave it for the legal interpretation if the matter reaches court someday. Still, if it is accepted that it can come under the word disaster, but the kind of orders of lockdown which is passed, the curfew, it is not, the word is not used in the scheme of the entire act. The guidelines can be issued, but the manner in which they have implemented, if we touch it to the touchstone of proportionality, that what they were trying to achieve and what damage did they cause. So the effort by the government, I believe, will not be able to stand a very objective judicial scrutiny. We are not here to discuss that. We are not even here to discuss that we did have three, four days time to prepare for a Janta curfew on 22nd. But on 24th, when this lockdown was announced, we had only 4 hours to go for many preparation, or maybe the lack of it, which that was the reason that many of our fundamental rights were very substantially affected, not just by the order of lockdown, but also the manner in which it has been done. So now it is up to us to analyze that the remedy, the thing which was sought to be remedied, cured, prevented, and the manner in which it is done is worse or had some balance with the objective which the government was trying to achieve. Despite this, that lockdown word is not defined under any Indian law. No, you can see all the statute, and please point out to me if lockdown word is ever used in any of the Indian law. The lockdown, which is very pervasive order, it puts away all civil liberties. So many restrictions are on all civil rights, all civil liberties, movement, profession, trade, occupation, reside, privacy, anything. Everything was totally not only diluted, undermined, it was completely done away with something, with a word which has any legal sanctity or any provision of law to justify it. I personally believe, subject to all other opinions on the other spectrum of this situation, it was a very poor, hasty, knee-jerk, reactionary implementation of a China's policy. The country which we know that how they treat their citizens and many things, like how whistleblowers are treated, how press is controlled. So we got the entire world got this idea of lockdown from China. So ironically, sometimes I laugh that there is a call to boycott Chinese products which are made by the innocent Chinese people. But without even blinking the eyes, the entire world wholeheartedly applied, accepted without raising critical analysis, something which was a ruthless brainchild of authoritarian Chinese government. So I don't know, I have not read Chinese constitution, even if they have one. We know China is a communist country and how they deal their citizens. So whatever the China did in Wuhan, we simply followed it without looking into our legal documents, without looking into our harsh realities, and without even seeing how it's going to impact many, many lives. So just to now analyze that how our constitution rights are affected by this lockdown order, we go again back to the constitution, because the government which is passing the order originates through the provisions of constitution. And the same constitution also has given us a right to live as a respectable citizen with a bundle of rights to live, not only live, but live with a dignity and many other rights. Now, and Article 13, I'm re-emphasizing that it cannot take away our fundamental right. The law passed by the government is specifically prohibited from compromising with our fundamental right, no matter what. Now, people say that no, there was a pandemic. It was an extraordinary situation. The court has to take, the government has to take a very extraordinary measures to deal with the situation. So I asked myself that what was this extraordinary situation? What was the public interest? We understand that, yes, there was a disease, there was a pandemic. So before we understand the legality of situation arising in a pandemic, we must understand that pandemic has a more of a medical side than a legal side. Legal side is only to see that whatever action is being taken on the medical advice and medical research and science comes within the four domains of legal provisions of that country and the constitutional framework. I don't want to get into the numbers here that, yes, many people were dying. So the governments, not only Indian government, many government worldwide have taken the decisions. I leave for you to make up your own mind about it. What was the manner of infection because of COVID-19? What was the impact of infection? What was the lasting impact of a disease? How much fatal it was? And if it was a fatal, what were the reasons of its fatality, the reason of its morbidity? If it was fatal for elders, that is elders and all people with the compromised immunity, why some elders in Italy who were above the age of 100 have survived? So what is the reason that the virus is actually 80% mild and 20% of that asymptomatic? And I leave this task again for you to understand what does it mean to be asymptomatic, how it correlates with your immunity, and why when we are overwhelmed with the data about how many people are dying, we are not finding any discussion about what it means to have a mild COVID, what it means to be asymptomatic COVID. Have we ever come across any disease which is asymptomatic? If you go back to Ebola, you see other diseases. Have we ever come across any disease which is asymptomatic? We don't understand situation of COVID, coronavirus here, having a very long incubative period. But we do have to understand that despite it's being fatal for people, its impact on people, many other people, much more than that. If 100 people are getting this disease, one or two are dying, 98 people are recovering. I'm not saying the two lives which are lost are not important. No, they have to be protected and we have to do our best. But we have to understand that 98% of the people were recovering. They were not having any special extra damage to their health. But to contain that people should not be affected from this virus, we have made many thousands of people compromise many of their rights, which I'm going to discuss with you now. My first thing which came to my mind is right to health and access to medical assistance being seriously compromised. It is very ironical and paradoxical that the issue of health of public, which is the reason behind the orders passed by the government of lockdown and other measures, that issue of health is compromised by that very order in a very, very damaging way. A right to health is essentially a part of Article 21 of Constitution. You will all read it, Article 21, because I'm going to take the reference of this, use this article again and again. You will read it yourself. I will only say here that this article pertains to right to life and liberty. And then from various interpretation given by the Supreme Court, the right to life has not just been mentioned as right to live as an animal existence. This is about your right to live with a dignity. So health doesn't mean freedom from just one virus. Health means your overall health, which should be mental, social, physical well-being. This is the definition of health in Declaration of Alma Malta. You all can see that health doesn't mean you don't have any infirmity or disease. Health means physical, social, intellectual, psychological well-being. So the reference used here is Jaan hai, Jahan hai. But what is that Jaan and what is that Jahan? Before we say that we have our Jaan, we have to protect it. But we have to protect that Jaan, which has its overall other things also intact. So I leave up to you that how do you see that what kind of mental, social, physical impact this lockdown has on people who were living at home and not able to go out, who were living in isolation. But most importantly, I want all of us to just think, during this lockdown, have we ever thought about the people who have much more serious diseases like cancer? What happened to their chemotherapy? There are people who are on constant dialysis. They are living in the places where they cannot, they don't have access to the treatment because the area is not very well developed. The health facilities are not available. Right to movement was very much badly restricted. How did they manage? I had a word with a doctor working in PGI, and he says the collateral damage to because of this lockdown to other people suffering from other diseases is much more than what COVID-19 would have caused if it had affected. In health issue, I think I just saw the time is 6:35 and I am able to touch only one right which has been violated. So I have to rush through what other rights I want to discuss with all of you. So, in right of health, we have seen the right of pregnant women to seek medical assistance also in compromise during this time. Right of abortion is very seriously compromised. Right of COVID patients are compromised because they are being forced to live in a certain hospital in a certain condition without their attendance, love and care and affection. And there are cases where their articles were snatched, their phones were taken away by the people because there is nobody else with them. But this is also a very difficult situation, and the way they have been quarantined and stigmatized, this will also be a very big violation of their right to privacy. I had a lot to speak on this right to health, but now I go to the next right, which is very badly compromised with this lockdown situation, is your right to livelihood. Again, it's a part of Article 21. And this right is not only, this violation is not only a violation of Article 21, but it is also a violation of Article 14, which says that the state shall bring everybody equally before it and its application of laws. But this lockdown order has come as extremely harsh to people like migrant workers, daily workers, mildly harsh to people who were self-employed and didn't have any bank account. And on the other spectrum, it has been very extremely empowering to some profession like who were making masks and sanitizers manufacturing. So this arrangement of lockdown, where some people were thriving, some people were all right managing, and some people have, you know, their life had come to a standstill. So this kind of arrangement without any plan how to deal with the situation has not only violated your Article 21 and its Article 14 right to equality also. Again, if we apply the principle of proportionality, was that act of the government proportionate the damage which is caused and the remedy which is sought to remedy was having some kind of balance or not? The third right, which is very badly affected, is right to justice. The courts are not able to work as they were working, though there is no prohibition as such on court working, but they are not able to work. We had a personal experience of here seeing how our high courts have rejected bail application. Again, the Article 14 is applicable here because there's a pick and choose of the courts, be it High Court, be it Supreme Court, in what matter to take, what matter not to take. We all saw how Mr. Arnab Goswami's matter was listed and relief was given to him within a few hours of listing, and where how it takes weeks to get the matter listed or matter is not listed. Even if it is listed, no relief is given. The Supreme Court could not see the migrants' pain, many other things. It's not just about, we were very surprised, the Supreme Court, which gave us a Vishakha guidelines, which everybody knows about sexual harassment at a workplace, and DK Basu, and many other things where the right of accused were protected. But here in COVID situation, the highest court has not done its duty as it should have done to uphold the right of the fundamental rights of the citizens, which have come under big threat because of these orders passed by the government. People, the domestic violence cases are rising. The incest problem is rising. I won't give you the data. I had it, but I leave it to you to research by yourself how many domestic violence cases are rising, how many suicides are rising, how many FIRs are rising. And the worst part is how political vendetta of the state is also rising. Everything is under lockdown, but the political vendetta is not under lockdown. We saw how activists were involved in social activism, and this time also they were doing their duty as a part of help to the society. They were arrested and then their bail application could not be heard as it should have because the courts are not able to function properly. And video conferencing again brings another Article 14 violation. The technology is not available to everyone. How many lawyers can actually argue through Zoom or through other applications, and now the Supreme Court has also come heavily up on the Zoom. And I don't know, I have not read the order, though I would like to, we should have a discussion on it, that how in the time when there is technology as such also, the courts are not very technological savvy and not able to do their work. Why, how can we come down on a application which has helped in conducting so many webinars and help the people to continue the spread of information and interaction. So, and the most important right, which the COVID-19 situation and the orders passed therein by the government and also by the conduct of the public at large has affected, is the right to privacy. So we had earlier judgment when Supreme Court says no privacy is not fundamental right, then said it is a fundamental right. But then there was a 2017 very important judgment of Puttu Swami. Everybody knows about it, that how it 9 judges unanimously said no. The right to privacy is intrinsic to life, liberty, freedom, dignity, and is inalienable right. Article 14, 19, 21, all these articles, equality, freedom of speech and expression, and right to life, includes in it right to privacy. So I'll be taking some time for you to take you to few important observations of the Supreme Court judgment, which will tell us that how important it is for us to understand what it means to be privacy and how we should raise our voice to safeguard this right, which has come to us after a long struggle. 1950, the Constitution, 1952, Supreme Court says no, 1960, Supreme Court says no, 75, a mild yes comes. And then finally in 2017, we got this judgment, which says right to privacy is a very, very important fundamental right. It actually embodies all other fundamental rights, which are given specifically to us by the Constitution of India. So it says that preservation of personal intimacy, marriage, family, sexual orientation is your right to privacy. Nobody will question you about that. The second thing the court says is right to left alone is a very important right of privacy. So if we see in the present context, what is happening to the COVID patients, the suspects, the people quarantined, other things, though maybe it is necessary evil in the present situation, but what happens to right to privacy, which was given to us by the court in 2017, and was this the only way to deal with the situation? The way their information is made public, everybody has come to know about it. The apps which are asking for your whereabouts every time, your surveillance. So all these things which have directly in conflict with the right, which has become our fundamental right, were they the only way to deal with this problem? If you want to know more about it, I request all of you to please go through 2005 European Court of Human Rights judgment in Enron versus Sweden, where it was HIV case and something similar, where the court held that right, the decision to solitarily confine somebody, detain somebody to prevent the disease, which could be spread, should be the last resort. So here also the very important question which we have to ask while asking for enforcement of our right to privacy is, were these the only way this problem would have been handled? There is in the privacy judgment, the court also says that the personal safeguards of autonomy and choices as way of life is very important. We have to respect everybody as they want to live. We know the entire situation of COVID-19 has brought vulnerability in our senior citizens, and we say that to protect them, we are taking this step, and there is a consistent warnings and advisories by the government for these people, for people above the age of 60, 65, not to come out. I had a very interesting personal experience where a senior resident of old age with whom I was interacting with specifically told me, is above 100, that I have lived my life. I have done whatever I want to do. I don't know whether I'll be alive today or tomorrow, because I'm more than 100. But in last days of my life, I have been forced to live in a jail. I can't go out to a temple. I can't go out to Gurdwara. I can't meet people. Nobody can come to meet me. So what kind of life? I have a very limited handful days with me. So this is again one angle which we have to see when we see that we are saving our elders from this disease, which is very, very dangerous for them. That what do they want? What is their choice as a way of life, which is preserved and protected by this judgment of our Supreme Court in Puttu Swami case? It also says that right to live with a dignity, to pursue happiness, to die with dignity is your right to privacy. We saw in the present situation how many parents could not attend their children's funeral. Very tragic situation. Vice versa also. I had a personal experience where a person, because of whatever happened in Tablighi Jamaat incident was not given pass because of being a Muslim to meet, to go for the cremation of his mother who was in Uttar Pradesh. So if we start giving the examples how the rights have been compromised in a very ugly manner under lockdown, we will not be able to do justice to anything which has been done by the government saying that this is for the protection and in the larger public interest. Right to dissent and right to question, right to scrutinize actions of government is a very important part of your right to privacy as said by 9 judges in this very judgment. So it is our duty, not only protecting our right to privacy, but also is our duty to question the government. Was lockdown the only option? When our act also says, see the other provisions of law. I'm not saying here that it was absolutely wrong, but we have to question, was it the only option? And the way it was done was the only option. On 13th March, when WHO declared its pandemic, our health ministry says it is not health emergency. Suddenly on 24th, we got this lockdown, which is called the harshest lockdown in the world. So the privacy judgment has also given us this very important right to dissent. Question the government, keep asking. This kind of situation arises, this kind of orders are passed because when the government knows that many of its citizenry is not going to render them accountable, they can do whatever experiment they want. We want a responsible, accountable, transparent government. That will happen only when we ask questions. And the ability to ask questions comes through our constitution, our right to life, which includes right to privacy, and right to privacy includes the right to dissent and ask questions. So, and the judgment also has told us that whatever is popular doesn't mean right, and we don't have to accept it. Questioning that popular sentiment and things which is happening in the society is also a very important part of your right to privacy. And here I would like to share with you that which it gave me a lot of pain when the people who were just sitting in their air-conditioned room, trying new recipes, playing Antakshri with their friends, suddenly when the migrants faced problem and they were forced to do certain things, to get into panic, get together, to travel together, to walk together, or maybe whatever happened in Bombay, and then they started shouting that these people will make the entire lockdown failure. So I think Sushmita has some message for me. Yes, Sushmita. I can't hear you. I think you, yes.
Yeah. Are we good now, ma'am?
Yeah.
All right. I'm very sorry to break you in the middle, ma'am, but I just wanted to remind you that we're running a little short of time.
Yes. I will. That's what I said. I've already started. You know, I'm not going into detail. I'm only going to very briefly mention what other rights were compromised. Just give me 5 more minutes. I won't take more than this. Because I am also very much keen to answer the question rather than getting to this monologue.
Sure.
So next, after the right to privacy, which is being compromised, the next right is right to education. Earlier, it used to be a part of our Article 21, but now we have Article 21A, which specifically says that right to education is a fundamental right. With this, online right to education is also seriously compromised. And then again, Article 14 comes into picture between haves and have-nots. These private schools, which can be afforded by the upper middle class and higher class, are having the online classes, but the students studying in the government schools are suffering. So their right to education is seriously compromised. Right to movement is compromised. People, which is a fundamental right under Article 19, people could not go. They were stuck because the curfew lockdown was imposed just like that without any warning to them. And they could not even go for their medical treatment. They could not go back wherever they were. The labor's problem, we all say. Very important thing which I want to discuss here is we had a right not to be untouchable. So Article 17 doesn't say that it's a right not to be untouchable, but Article 17, which is a part of a fundamental right chapter, says that untouchability is abolished in India. So what happened in COVID-19 times, we found a new way, new untouchables, the COVID suspects, the patients. We saw what happened to Muslims because of Tablighi Jamaat incident, which was not less than a genocidal incitement by media and other people. We see what happens to Northeast people because they resemble or they look like Chinese. So all these kind of things happen, especially after one, we have an act, we have a constitutional provision, it says untouchability. So untouchability is not just physical, you know, it's mental also. And our government It was not by the government directly, but our government did nothing on this aspect. And that is a very, 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 very sad situation, especially if you compare it with the country like Taiwan, where they understood the stigma attached to the COVID patient and they came up with a compassionate policy. So I request all of us, if our government is sleeping over it, we as a citizen, if we read our fundamental rights, we should be aware of our fundamental duties also. And 51AE specifically says that it is our fundamental duty to promote communal harmony and brotherhood. And if we don't do it, and if we do totally opposite to it, IPC awaits for you, 153A, 153B. We will talk about it because there is one of the question on it. So it is not only just our fundamental duty, fundamental right, it is the basic structure of our preamble of constitution, which talks about brotherhood. We have to live with love, especially in these times. Then we have to right to be specifically informed, which has not happened. Mask, no mask, ventilator, no ventilator, no one is giving us a proper information. The entire obsession with the data. I leave it to you how we should think more about it, that how our right to be informed is seriously compromised. Then the last right is right to be properly administered. I have seen written many things on it, but because of the time constraint, I'm not going to mention it. I'm just going to say one thing, that Spanish flu also has these non-pharmaceutical interventions, NPIs, which happened in 1918, which is called a Bombay fever also, which was in India for 1.5 years under the colonial government. And Mahatma Gandhiji also, I came across an article saying that he also contracted Spanish flu, but recovered, which was much more fatal than what disease we have right now. But still, that time also, the kind of orders which were passed by the government, by the colonial government, were found to be too aggressive, too harsh, and too divisive in the society, as it is happening right now also. They wanted to have a different kind of war, which happened in Gujarat for the different caste. So that time also, the conduct of the government, which was the colonial government, was not very good. Today also, when we see, the situation has not changed. I would just sum up this monologue by just saying that the problem which we are facing, and my understanding, is not the virus, it is the fear of the virus. So fear of the virus, which is much more dangerous than the virus itself. If we really, really want to meet this virus and defeat it, we have to get out of this fear completely. The fear of death is much worse than death itself. And I would sum up my entire thing about that we have surrendered our rights, maybe under the compulsion of orders by the government. I've seen many people wanting it to be done because they think that life is under threat. So I would just, for them and for everyone, I would just quote a quote of Benjamin Franklin. He said, "Those who would give up essential liberty to purchase a little temporary safety deserve neither liberty nor safety." So this is how I end up, that you just for the few something safety, you for safety, you cannot compromise your liberty. And your liberty is just not living as an animal existence. It comprises of many other rights, which we just discussed today. And I would request all of you once again to please have your vitamin curiosity every day. Have your mental immunity before you go for your physical immunity. Be more compassionate. Understand other people's problem. Be aware and vocal about your rights, and just remember that justice is not done by the provisions of law. Justice is done by the conscience which is seated in your heart. So that's it, Sushmita.
Wow. I think you summed it up beautifully, and the matter of all that you've mentioned is going to take a lot of time to crunch, but I feel a lot more motivated through your entire journey, because I think we started with the very fundamentals of what it means to live, and to live how. Not just merely exist, but to know what it comes with, to know what to ask for, and to live very peacefully and harmoniously with others around us. So it's not something that affects only us, but everyone around us. I think the fact that you were able to go into detail technically and also brush through, it must be quite a skill to be in a profession and speak so quickly. I mean, I applaud you personally for that. It's beautiful.
I really like your, you know, intervention in between. It many times happens when the judges tell us, please wind up your argument fast. We can't. So, you know, we're quite used to it, that we know whenever, at any time, the judge might ask us to conclude.
I understand. So we had a very important set of questions that came in, and without much further ado, I'd like to thank you for bringing us to notice the wonderful points. And I'm pretty sure you've very beautifully covered all the things that we were looking forward to hear also. We're going to take the liberty of extending this session a little bit. Hopefully you're also agreeable to that.
I'm comfortable.
Perfect. And let's jump into the questions right away. Thank you for all of you who've written to us from your registration forms and who have been participating and showing us love and support through our live cast. Thank you so much. It brings up our morale a lot more. And I'm pretty sure Tanu ma'am also is very, very happy to be speaking to you all. So questions. Ma'am, I'd like to digress a little bit and ask you something from your personal experience.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so you've had a career that you had to represent criminals, and you volunteered to tell us how this can be difficult. See, this conversation, this webinar is also looking at not being one-sided about our opinions.
Absolutely.
So how do we build that in our communication skills that we're able to really open up as people and look beyond them as just criminals or as convicts
yes.
of any kind?
Yes, yes. Sushmita here, I would like to share one thing with you that I cannot tell you that do something like I have said, take a vitamin curiosity, like take a vitamin non-judgment, being non-judgmental and you will be in one day. No. From my personal experience, I can tell you when I joined the profession in 2003, I was very, very uncomfortable representing convicts of drugs cases, rape cases, other things. And I was like, wow, what am I doing? I'm not doing justice to the society. But with the passage of time, as I grew in profession and understood many things of it, especially about the right of fair trial of the accused, the CAB rule, which is not known to many people, which was in UK, not applicable as such, but it's a part of our Advocates Act that CAB rule means in UK that whenever you ask any car, taxi to stop, it has to take you. It can't say no. So that is applicable to advocates also, that like a doctor, anybody who comes to your chambers, you have to take that case no matter what, even if you personally don't agree to it, unless you have some other conflict of interest. So that was the first thing which technically made me feel that no, it is our duty to represent anyone who has come to us. But with the passage of time, the black and white area of being criminal or being victim, it blurred. So when you go through those cases, you understand that every victim has some negative shade in it, every criminal has a positive shade in it, and vice versa, and many things. So by having an experience of dealing with the case practically, you stop being judgmental. And this journey has not happened overnight. It takes a lot of time. It takes reading a lot of things. Shantaram has played a very important role in making me what I am today, where I don't judge people, much less my clients or criminals. I used to judge them before. I used to represent them, and I used to judge them. But Shantaram played a very important role. I request all the youngsters who have not read this novel to please read it. You will be able to see life through the eyes of a convict who was on the run, what are their problems, and why you should not judge them. And when we deal with many cases during the process, this judgment gradually starts going away. I think your compassion, being a lawyer, I'm into a spirituality a lot. I believe in it. So that also helped. I don't know about the other lawyers, but I seriously today, I'm in the position, I don't judge either my client or the opposite side. Even if I'm representing one side, I do understand the concern of other side. I do understand where they are coming from, and I don't judge them that I'm representing the opposite side, so they are wrong. No. We are just representing two sides which have their own story.
Sure. Thank you very much, ma'am. I think it does take a lot of maturity to do this. And we understand where you're coming from. So one of our listeners has asked, with prevailing complexities and shortage of medical staff and services, what would be the rights of a person who loses life because the necessary services were directed towards curbing the virus?
So definitely, as I said, that you're right. Even the doctors are saying so, that the collateral damage where the other health issues which also necessitated prompt medical attention or other kinds of continued medical attention is compromised, your right to life is definitely being compromised. And as our Supreme Court only has said that state has a responsibility to protect your life, and if state has failed in its duty, then definitely state can be sued.
Okay. All right, ma'am. So another question brings up the lot of mismanagement at various levels that has happened. And we've observed that that mismanagement, miscommunication has led to a lot more threatening situations than the crisis and lockdown itself. So how do we deal with that? Does this mean that the transparency is helping us evolve towards a better structure?
I think the Corona time, the COVID-19 situation time is a wake-up call and it's asking us to introspect many things. Personally also, it is a time for all of us to restart our button. And as a government also, the government must look into the way it has worked so far, and especially in the present crisis. The entire situation system has to re-engineer itself. We saw that the entire decision making was given to the bureaucrats. They are not experts. I have specifically discussed this problem with the doctors. They said that they were on paper joined in the meetings, but their ideas were not accepted by the bureaucrats. And what they were saying, especially about these health issues of other persons and other things, they were not taken into consideration. So our government, there is a lot to be blamed, there is a lot to be said that can await. But right now, you know, we have to undo the damage which has been done. So I personally believe that government should get up. They should get out of this petty politics that Congress, BJP, this government, that government. They must invite ideas from everyone. There should be decentralization. Only one person sitting at the top will not tell you to just, you know, bang your plates and light the air. Should be decentralized, and every person in that particular area seeing the requirement of that area, that this has to be dealt in this manner. They should be given the freedom. The leadership is not just about taking the calls. Leadership is about delegating and letting the people take the decision. And most importantly, they should start listening to doctors more. You just listen to many doctors, what they are saying. Even the protocol of their treatment is decided by these bureaucrats who are not doctors. So this has to change. This really has to change. The bureaucrats, the IS system, which we have got from the, which has the colonial legacy in it, this has to be revamped, because we see how we elect our IS officials who are just into their books. They are not close to the ground realities. Even the doctors are not. And the doctors are working on it, that by, because they keep reading their books, they don't understand the society's complexities, what is required to be done at the ground level. Life is not about the books and passing orders on the government stationery. So I think this mismanagement can be really, really very much managed if there is a vision, there is an open-mindedness, and there is a desire to take everybody along as a community participation. Let people say that they have a say about their community life. Let it, every particular area, every particular city should be left free to decide for themselves as per their requirements.
Yes, ma'am. I have a few more follow-ups on the number of points that you mentioned here, but we'll cover the questions that we've been asked first. One is that the legal framework for associations that is imposing unnecessary restrictions in apartments. Is there any legal limitation for such associations?
No. There is that. Those are totally unconstitutional. You have your Article 19 and you have your Article 21, your right to life. But the kind of restrictive orders which these associations are passing are completely wrong. I can't give you judgment, but there's a judgment by the Supreme Court where certain provisions of this society, that this person will enter, this person will not enter after this time, were held to be unconstitutional. They cannot do so. They have no authority. They have their association only flows from their particular bylaws, regulation under the Societies Act, that only give them power to govern the administrative part of the society. They cannot infringe upon how you live as a human being. So wherever they are infringing upon your fundamental, see, even state government, whom you have elected, who's the supreme in the constitution, Article 13 says cannot pass any law which will take away your fundamental rights. How can these associations who are just private entities and who also owe their origin to some bylaws of the law can take away those rights? Those acts are totally unconstitutional. You must challenge them.
All right, ma'am. So in the view of these related issues, there's also been a lot of racism and increase of discrimination. Here, I'd like to point out that though this is an obvious thing, and we've seen that the factors of discrimination have been very different in different societies, how can we really come up with these cases? Because it's become a sort of normalcy to accept that this is how our country has become, or this is how society has become, that respect is not easily available. So how do we really bring back that dignity, and would a law help in that case?
Yes, law certainly can help. And I here would like to share my understanding of the situation, that the COVID-19 situation did not bring out something new. I believe it amplified what was already existing in our society for the last so many years. So we really need to introspect from where it started, how it started. The mob lynching cases, we were not very vocal about it. Ostracization, we were not vocal about it. The attack on Northeast is not a new phenomenon. It happened before also. We were not vocal about it. We were not talking about it. So gradually, now in the pandemic situation, when we all were sitting at home, we had nothing else to do. Whatever was in our mind, it came out. So it amplified what was already existing. We really need to work on it. There's a lot of damage has been done to the society. As I already said, this is our fundamental duty to promote communal harmony. So we should understand that whenever we listen to anyone who's passing any racial remark, we just cannot keep quiet. We have to give the counter, and we have to stop that step therein. As far as law is concerned, our IPC has specific provision 153A, 153B. You must be aware, many of the news anchors have been booked under these sections who tried to incite communal disharmony during Tablighi Jamaat incident and later on also. So there is a provision of law which was not used before. But yes, it is a time whenever I have personally warned my close family member who were sending me some kind of Islamophobic messages during Tablighi Jamaat, that if you send another message, you will be booked under 153A and B of IPC. I'm going to lodge an FI. So, and this is how we have to do in our groups. Whenever you come across any such message, tell that person politely that, being a well-wisher, I'm just warning you, next time there might be somebody who can go and, it's a cognizable case, means an FIR can be registered. And we must do that. And then second thing which we can do is we should have more interaction of people from different religion, different races, together on some platform, so that everybody should come to know each other, that there is not we versus another. We are same. We have to have more interaction, and we should convince our government also, persuade them as well, their cultural ministry, that please organize such events where people come across together. And why don't we have songs like Mile Sur Mera Tumhara and other songs like Desh Mein Pyar Ki Ganga Bhai. Why are we not having these kind of songs which I don't know about your generation time, but we had grown up on those songs, and it is really very close to our heart. So we need to work on it. And yes, people, after one warning, now 150, the zero tolerance, 153A and 153B, no, you cannot. We cannot allow this.
Absolutely, ma'am. It's difficult, but I think it needs to be done, and we need to fight for it. There's a very relevant thing that you spoke about, the media being independent and having to take up a case of accountability on behalf of the people. And I mean, I must ask this, because while the cases of misinformation spread, and we have a lot of fake news, unnecessary things that are being thrown to, you know, distract us, like gossip from Bollywood or who's wearing what or whatever. Yes. But we also have an actual case of real journalism that brings out the truth and that brings criticism in a healthy manner up to front. And not a lot of people are subscribed to this, but they are facing, in terms of all of this crisis also, they are facing immediate action. Even yes. if it means that they get to go to jail for one day.
Yes, yes.
So imagine the threat that the government faces, that even for one day, they don't mind actioning that quickly. How can law step in for this? Because both we see are pillars.
Yeah, ultimately, Sushmita, I believe the law is not something existing in a vacuum, that something, if something goes wrong, it will come and, you know, salvage you out of that situation. The law is implemented and through the courts, and the courts are manned by the judges. We saw in their recent past, very unfortunate, how the judges have behaved and how what kind of orders they have passed. Law, there is a lot of provision. You have your Article 19, which is the freedom of speech and expression. That right cannot be taken away from you. And that has to be, and Supreme Court is the custodian of our fundamental rights. Article 32 says that right to move to Supreme Court is a fundamental right itself. So there is a lot of duty on Supreme Court to protect. On paper, as I said, yes, there is lot of provisions. Your entire life, your all bundle of rights to live is dignity are protected. But the question is, when it has to be implemented, it has to be implemented by the people. The problem right now is why these media houses are facing threat and are the government is able to take on to them their personal vendetta with impunity, because we know the courts will not do anything. I don't know what has happened. It happened earlier also. Emergency 1975 is one example. Today we see Mr. Arnab Goswami getting an order within few hours, but we don't see the other journalist of the Wire who was arrested, the activist who have been arrested, that there are even bail applications being heard. His quashing petition was entertained within few hours. So in this situation, and I think we just can't blame judiciary or the Supreme Court for this kind of functioning. We all have to see that what actually has happened to the entire society in last few years, because we have stopped asking questions. It is not just about the media people who are into investigating journalism who are under threat. The activists are under threat. Many people who are doing good work under threat. And this is happening because majority of us are not asking questions to the government. The government knows if they say this is night and not the day, majority of the people are going to believe it. So we have to, that is why I started my discussion today, that please question everything. I'm not saying maybe I have my reasons. I have studied the government from a different point of view. I'm very biased against government. Maybe I'm wrong. You do your independent evaluation of the working of the government, the way they are handling situation, the way the problem is rising, the way they are managing, the way they are witch hunting people who are doing the job. A good job. Just try to study both sides. Just don't believe the government version. Maybe the government version is right, but try to see the other version also. So in my understanding, the situation might change if many of us start being more vocal, start asking government the questions. So one day, even the Supreme Court will get the courage back to ask the government a question. And once the government knows that, so government may not be afraid of Supreme Court, but the government is definitely afraid of its citizens, its vote bank. When, if they start asking questions, they definitely will change their way. So only way out from this law is there on the paper, but it has to be implemented by the people, and people have to change their attitude. Justice begins with the heart and conscience, as I said.
Wow. Yeah. So ma'am, it's a very similar question that threads along this note. So the case, the legal side actually deals with very critical cases of morality and ethics, as we understand in society. While the judicial system is supposed to uphold this, it also teaches us how to bend it. So how do we ensure that we as a society stop trusting the institution because of the delays or because of bureaucracy or because of its lack of efficiency in the last few years? We don't want to encourage people to become ignorant and unaware and start taking action by themselves. So what would you suggest in this front?
Same thing which I just asked, the question is quite connected to the earlier question. And the answer also would be on the similar lines, that yes, we have to educate ourselves. We have to give right information to ourselves. We have to be aware of our rights. We have to be aware of our right as an individual, right as a part of the society, of the community. And we should understand one thing, Sushmita, that the people who are sitting in this institution are not coming from some other planet. They are part of us. We have to see as a society what has gone wrong where. What are we teaching our children? What are we what kind of books are they reading? Are we reading? Why we have stopped asking questions? What has happened to morals? Why the judges who know that they are going to decide people's destiny, are not able to do their job judiciously as they were doing before? Yes, ADM Jabalpuri is a dark phase, but that is an aberration. If you see the kind of judgment Supreme Court used to pass during those days, upholding the rights of accused. In fact, I wanted to say one thing in access to justice is after a lot of struggle, Supreme Court passed a judgment that a person cannot be handcuffed. Many of you will not be aware that you cannot be handcuffed. You can't be put into bar fetter. It is a violation of dignity of right of an individual. They said that prison walls does not block the way of the rays of constitution into it. You might be not allowed to interact with the society, but as an individual, your Article 21 is protected. In the present times, the courts are allowing application, maybe it is necessity, to handcuff the accused because police officers are afraid of touching the accused because of the COVID-19 situation. So the right which we got after a lot of struggle in COVID-19 situation, just like this, and I don't know what court was thinking about morals and ethics, as you rightly said, bend it down the way convenient, immediately allowed those applications, just thinking, oh yes, COVID-19 situation, you can't touch the person, handcuff allowed. They did not even pause to think about some other ways that how we can protect the police and also we can protect the dignity of an accused, which was protected way back in 83's judgment of Prem Chopra. So I think it all comes down to what are we doing to us by what we giving to our mind here, like the food we eat. If it is a healthy food, make us physically healthy person. What are we putting it here? Are we listening to a lot of media? Are we listening to a lot of gossip? We blame the media, but who watches them? Why can't we take a resolve that we will not watch these televisions who are inciting communal disharmony, who are inciting violence, who is showing us rubbish? So it is just not about that, it is entire responsibility comes to the institution. The responsibility is on us also, because from us as an individual, only people are going and becoming a part of that institution.
So ma'am, I think we've covered a range of topics, everything that we can manage in this time frame. I'm afraid we're going to have to close the session very shortly. And I'm very glad that you very intuitively picked up all the questions and summed up a very beautiful story for us. So I'm very, very grateful for this session. We all are, for your immediate participation and your high level of information and enthusiasm. So I'm going to conclude this ceremony with a lot of thanks and with a lot of gratitude for all of you listeners who've been constantly telling us what kind of sessions we should bring, what kind of speakers we should bring, and for constantly showing up every weekend, for supporting us, for following us, and for really making this learning a very joint situation for all of us. Like we face the pandemic together, we will also learn and grow from it together. I thank Mindsperm, who's given us this opportunity to conduct the virtual webinar series. It is our grand 10th special edition today. And we've had a range of brilliant speakers. And we end with Tanuji, who's just finished wrapping up for us the legal side of the pandemic. I'm sorry, I apologize for earlier where I had a little bit of internet issues. So I'm just going to rephrase that we are in collaboration with a Sangh initiative. You can find this on our YouTube link and our social media links as well. They're doing a lot of good work for bringing up supplies and donations and volunteering for bringing the essentials to people in and around Delhi and Ghaziabad. So please do go and look them up. Do your little bit, but do keep activating your minds and activating your rights. This too shall pass. And I think we're good. I think in conclusion, we can say that it's not just up to an institution or just one stellar moment of genius that changes everything, but like tiny little steps And every question, every inquiry, and every change from within that molds us as society. So do keep educating and getting aware. Do keep the social spirit alive. We are only physically distanced. And hopefully not for too long as well. So thank you so much. Ma'am, any final words that you'd like to add in?
Same thing which I was saying before. Keep asking questions. Take vitamin curiosity every day. And please, 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 please stay away from fear. More importantly than as you have to stay away from the virus. Don't have any fears. Live your life full on. You will get only once. And thank you. Thank you so much. It has been a very, very wonderful pleasure experience of having this discussion on Mindspan platform with you, Sushmita. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. All the best for more endeavors in the future. Thank you so much. And thank you, everybody. Thank you.